This Headless Professor video is about confounding variables. Sometimes they're called missing variables, lurking variables, extraneous variables, third variables, or hidden variables. This is the kind of variable that is a potential cause of the dependent variable, and it has a potential influence, but we really don't know what kind of variable it is, because this variable was one that was not held constant, it was not randomized, it was not manipulated in the experiment, and it was not even measured. The problem with these confounding variables is that they impact our ability to make causal inferences. They do not impact our ability to use predictions just to figure out cause and effect relationships. Let's look at some examples of confounding variables. Let's suppose you studied infant circumcision as an independent variable and the rate of sexually transmitted diseases as the dependent variable. About 100 years ago in Europe, it was noticed that there was a correlation between these two variables. And the assumption was that if we simply circumcised more males, we could reduce the rate of sexually transmitted diseases, especially syphilis. The problem is there were various confounding variables, such as religion, ethnicity, and social class, because it was largely Jewish men that were being circumcised as infants. And so we were really dealing with a comparison, perhaps, of some of the norms of sexual behavior in Jewish culture. Well, let's take a look at some other examples of confounding variables. Have you ever seen studies that correlated the school attended and the SAT score of the student? Well, there does seem to be some relationship between these two, but is it solely because of the school attended? Maybe it has something to do with some of these confounding variables, like the education level of the parents, the wealth of the parents, and the entire geography of the neighborhood in which the school is located. I spent a lot of time in the last 20 years looking at variables like birth order and their relationship with personality. And I've seen all kinds of correlation. But birth order, of course, could be related to other variables such as family size. And family size could be influenced by religion. Religious people tend to have more children. Ethnicity, certain ethnic groups have more children, and social class. So all of these factors could account for those relationships between birth order and personality. I've also done a number of studies on handedness, trying to figure out, do left-handed people, for example, have differences in personality? And we can certainly find correlations there. However, could there be confounding variables in genetics? Is it really the same gene that creates handedness that causes people to have certain different personality traits? Or could there simply be other genes associated with handedness that actually result in those personality traits? Let's look at one specific example of a research study and try to see the many confounding variables that would exist under different kinds of research designs. Suppose you're interested in studying China's one-child policy and how that might be related to the personality of only children. Well, what are we going to do for research design that would help us figure out these personality factors of the one-child policy? Are we going to compare the majority of Chinese families that do have only one child with those of the scofflaws that have more than one child? Well, unfortunately, there are other confounding variables separating the scofflaws from those who adhere to the one-child policy. For example, there's religious differences. The people who tend to have more than one child tend to be more religious in China. Geography, urban dwellers versus those living in the far western provinces. And then there would be differences in ethnicity, the Han Chinese versus the Uyghurs, for example, and also differences in wealth. Of course, we could compare people on the Chinese mainland with immigrant Chinese in other countries, such as Singapore, Taiwan, Canada, or even the United States. Unfortunately, we're thereby adding other confounding variables, such as the new culture or economic system that the Chinese immigrants find themselves. And also remember that immigration always remains a selective process. Immigrants are not a random sample from the host country. These are individuals who chose to go abroad. Of course, we could compare present Chinese children with data on personality traits of Chinese children pre-1970 when the one-child policy was adopted. Unfortunately, there have been a lot of other changes in China since then, especially changes in economics. Well, if we want a solution to the problem of confounding variables, the best solution is a large sample size. With a large sample size, we can do better randomization of these variables. Also, when it comes to experiments, we can do factorial designs, have more than two groups that we're going to compare. And if we're doing a survey, we could analyze that survey with structural equations, assuming that we've measured these other possible confounding variables. And if we don't have a large N, the best thing we can probably do is to control the homogeneity of the sample so that we're only looking at one particular well-defined group of people, and that will actually help us prevent these other confounding variables. It may limit the degree to which we can generalize our findings, but that's the best we can do with a small sample size. Well, those are some suggestions about confounding variables.